And joining us on the line right now is Shulpan Primbetova. Primbetova? Am I saying it correctly? Primbetova. And you are in Almaty, Kazakhstan, which I got to tell you is so special to me right now. First of all, thank you so much for joining us today. I've been doing a feature on my radio show where I'm calling people all over the world to see how they're dealing with the pandemic, with staying at home and sheltering in place. So I definitely want to talk to you about that. But before we get into that, Shulpan, is that how you pronounce it?
Yes, Shulpan, Nicole. Yes, correct.
Shulpan, you are in Almaty, Kazakhstan, and I was there 20 years ago to adopt my daughter, who at the time was about 18 months old, and now today is her 21st birthday. So,
well, congratulations. Happy birthday.
Thank you so much, and I will tell her. And, you know, on my mind today is a woman in Kazakhstan, in Almaty, who left this month-old baby girl on the doorstep of a private home, obviously because she couldn't take care of her. And this little baby was then taken to a baby home, eventually the one in Karakistak, where I went and met her and adopted her. In October, it'll be 20 years, but today is her, we think today is her 21st birthday. It's sometime this week. We don't know for sure the exact date. But so my thoughts today are with that woman who very unselfishly gave her up, knowing that she could find a better home. So it's so special that I'm connecting with you today. So tell me, what is happening in Kazakhstan with the coronavirus, with COVID-19? Is it very widespread there? And what precautions have they taken there?
So in comparison with European countries in the United States, we are more or less better because we use the Asian experience of immediate lockdown. And for now, we have around 3,500 cases, and less with 1% of death cases among, it's 25 people who died. So it's relatively much, much better than you guys are doing in the States.
A lot better.
Yeah. So the Minister of Health, they took immediate measures to lock down first big cities and then the whole country. So we are sitting at home starting from March 15th.
Wow.
And we tried to do no any social distancing, wearing masks, gloves when I go grocery. We try to go grocery less, not like every day we used to go and buy some fresh stuff. So we try to plan accordingly and go once a week. So it's very challenging because people in Kazakhstan, you probably know, something like Italians, we like to hug the individual people, we like to socialize, drinking tea, coffee together, and we have bigger families with grandchildren, and grandparents, and extended generation. And for us, socializing, it's a norm. So this is what our people are most struggling.
Right.
And then it's raining, it's cold, it's fine to sit at home, but then it's like sunshine and spring is everything is blossoming, fruit trees are wonderful, tulips are everywhere, and it's really like calling you to go outside, and this is where you have to be, I guess, self-disciplined.
Have they let you know when the lockdown might let up?
Yeah, so preliminary we have planned for May 11th.
Huh? Soon.
So people, very hopeful that it's very like it's coming. But and some businesses will be open, but it won't be like immediate open for everything. So we think that schools will continue to be doing online, schools and universities and colleges. So I guess they will finish this spring semester online. And there is the agencies or organizations have to take responsibility and see if they have to be in the office. People probably will go, but we will think if we still can work from home. So it's a new life. And we think that in summer it will be better, but what forecast says, maybe in the fall it will be a new outbreak. So people are thinking how they can get prepared to be a lockdown in in the fall.
Right. Yes, we're having the same discussions. Now let me ask you this. Is testing available widely in Kazakhstan? If you feel like you're getting sick, are you able to easily obtain a test for COVID-19?
Yes, some tests are for free if you are on the group risk. If you have pneumonia or you're elder or you have really like symptoms, you can get it for free or call emergency, they will come take you. But if you are feeling okay, but you wanted to double check yourself, if you're suspicious, if you have been in contact with someone who have been caught in, so then you have to pay.
So
there are
pay.
Different prices, yeah, but it's still available, but it's costly.
Now, what happens if you get sick? What is the healthcare system like in Kazakhstan? Over here, we have a very primitive system where we have to pay for private, for-profit health insurance from a big insurance company. It's a very flawed system. What kind of healthcare system is in Kazakhstan?
It's for free. So if you get tested and you are positive, they will put you to quarantine for 2 weeks. And we'll do PCR double checking with the testing, and then you will go for treatment. They try to choose the best protocol. They were looking at the Chinese protocols, European protocols, and they confirm the national protocol. So you get free testing and treatment.
Free treatment. Now, what about forget COVID, forget the coronavirus? Not that it's easy to do, but let's try for a moment. Just say it was a year ago, and you, God forbid, came down with cancer. What happens then? Do you just go to the doctor and you're taken care of?
Yes, for diagnosis, you can get tested for free,
mm-hmm.
And then for the surgeries, you sign up. And there is like a list that they have to, if you wanted to get surgery for free, you have to be signed and confirmed. Sometimes you have to wait, but it's still possible to get free surgeries here.
Okay.
If you don't like the national protocols and you have money, okay, people usually go to South Korea, Germany, Israel, some people travel to Russia. It's up to you. Local protocol available and local treatment is available.
Wow. And that's all part. It's paid for basically out of your taxes, yes?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
See, we don't have that here. It's kind of nuts. Have you heard about the American healthcare system? It's a for-profit venture so that you need insurance and it costs a lot of money, like hundreds and hundreds of dollars a month to be covered. And then when you go to the doctor, the hundreds of dollars you pay each month doesn't cover you. You still have to pay what they call co-pays. So in addition to what you pay the insurance company, you also pay the doctor. And that's after you meet what's called a deductible. So the thousands of dollars you may pay over the course of a year still isn't enough. In some cases, like in my case, I have to pay $2,600 out of my pocket before the insurance begins paying. And so for people who get really sick, a lot of people go bankrupt because they just don't have the insurance coverage. Or even people with insurance, the co-pays and deductibles are so high that they still lose everything just because they got sick. It's kind of crazy.
We are going to introduce this. We have voluntary insurance, like my employer is getting me. It's like a social package. But what we are trying to introduce here is mandatory insurance as well.
Is what? So, I'm sorry, what kind of insurance?
Like obligatory, mandatory.
Mandatory. Mandatory insurance. Got it.
Yeah. So every those who are working, it automatically will be deducted from our salaries.
Oh, wow.
in order to be covered.
Yeah, it sounds like.
Of course, the amount of money is not like in the States.
Right. But still, it sounds like American capitalism is creeping into things over there. It sounds better without this system. So, Shulpan Primbatova, Your English is great. Can I ask what you do for a living?
I work for the Columbia University Global Health Research Center of Central Asia. I got my master in social work at Columbia University School of Social Work in the city of New York.
Wow.
And I got my diploma in 2009. And I joined this Global Health Research Center of Central Asia, which is based in Almaty, a regional office in Almaty, right after I graduated in 2009. And since that, I work here as a deputy regional director. So what I studied in Colombia, at Colombia Social Work, we do it here. And my background in pharmacy and medicine, so we combine this knowledge. And we work with vulnerable people populations who are vulnerable to HIV, TB, sexually transmitted infections. We work with people living with HIV, people using drugs, LGBT community, commercial sex workers, so they who are under the risk.
Wow. Well, that sounds like a very important job. So good for you. A lot of people, you know, when I adopted my daughter, and I would say, oh, I adopted my daughter from Kazakhstan.
She's adorable.
Isn't she adorable? She is. And I can't believe she's 21 today. A couple of questions, though. Kazakhstan shut down international adoptions, or at least adoptions to the United States after, you know, I adopted Allison. Do you know what the status is now? Do you have any idea about the adoption programs there and the baby homes, the orphanages, like the one in Karakastak where she was, if it's still even there?
So what I know, it's shut down for international adoption, but it's open for local. Uh-huh. Now it's more electronic than probably you adopted Allison 20 years ago. It was all paperwork and communication by phone for some agencies. Mm-hmm. Here it's much more electronic. Everyone can go online and it's like constantly updating online. So every child who's left at the maternity house or go to the how we call this houses?
Not a baby home?
Each baby home in every city, they go online, register this baby, and everyone is like available immediately online.
So oh, wow.
It's less corrupted now.
Mm-hmm.
Like you cannot, everything is online. But we have business people who are very social responsible, and they think that some young ladies who got pregnant and they think that it's bad to have children out of wedlock, not to be married. It's bad for the community, for the reputation of their children. In order for them not just to leave child, they give them the second chance, and they call it houses of mom, homes of mom. It's absolutely covered by business people.
Wow.
In Kazakhstan. You can come to this home for moms with your child, get registered and live there, literally, like stay, live for at least 1 year. They take care, like psychologists, nurses, doctors,
wow,
gynecologists will take care of you. You get free living, free treatment and free food, and people will take care of your child. So for this year, women can like raise her child, try to get either educated or get job,
right,
and not to give up her child.
That's so a great program. And look, my heart hurts because I wonder if a program like that had been available for Allison's birth mother, if things might have been different. Now, she is my daughter in every sense of the word. She couldn't be any more my daughter if I had given birth to her. She is my kid. But my heart hurts for her birth mother, especially today. Like I said, I'm thinking about her from the moment I woke up and wonder if a program like that was available 21 years ago, if things would have been different.
It's a very good chance for young ladies who...
That's great. Again, we don't have programs like that over here, and I think it's a shame. Oh God, I'm like crying, and I'm sorry about that. It's an emotional day for me, obviously. And Allison's inside sleeping, or I would bring her in here to meet you. My mind is just spinning in a million different directions. So back then, again, it was 20 years ago when I adopted her. It was October 23rd and 24th of 2000, and the culture was sort of like it was here back in the 50s, where people didn't really adopt babies. It was not very common, and that's why there were so many international adoptions. And as I said, Allison was a foundling. She was left on someone's doorstep. In the translation is described as a household bag with she was wrapped in a blanket. She had a little hat on. She had a bottle. There were some things in there with her. And obviously, her birth mother left her on the doorstep of a private home, hoping these people would take care of her. I have the address of the house where she was left. They called the police. She was brought to the hospital and then the baby home. I was told by our adoption coordinator, a wonderful, amazing woman named Galia, that when somebody in Kazakhstan does decide to adopt, they will often feign pregnancy for 9 months, or they'll adopt a baby and move to a new town where people don't know the baby was adopted. Here in like the 1950s, that was the attitude, and people didn't, there were kids growing up who didn't even know they were adopted. Her adoption is part of our story that we told since she was very, very little. You know, it's our story, how we came together. Have attitudes changed there in the last 20 years or 21 years? Or is adoption more feasible to people who live, who are from Kazakhstan?
This is a huge difference. Yeah, I guess this is what's how we are different with cultures, and you absolutely agree that here it used to be, and in many, especially rural area and even in urban area, it's a very high secret to tell the child and anyone else that the child is adopted. But in almost 100%, the child is getting older, someone from friends or relatives will tell the child that he or she was adopted. And it's so painful to realize when you are old enough that your parents like are not your biological parents.
Right.
And it's a huge barrier. So it's still, if the child is adopted under 1 year, or maybe like around 1-2 years, mm-hmm. parents try to hide it, the child is adopted, because we are not raised in this how to tell. Maybe it's like a special program to teach the parents that it's fine to tell your child that you are not biological mom, yeah. And learn how to be a mom. It doesn't matter who gave you the birth. Yeah, it's more important who is your real mom. Yeah,
yeah.
But in some cases, those families who wanted to adopt children from children's houses in older age, mm-hmm. then child of course is realizing maybe age of 5 and older, then child, like, then they
know it. Sure,
they know, yeah,
right.
But for those single moms or ladies who are in their 40s, they are educated, they have good job, but somehow they didn't meet someone, they didn't fall in love, mm-hmm. and they couldn't deliver by themselves because of their reproductive function, or maybe they just didn't find a nice donor. They tried to adopt and tried to fight.
Right. Well, that was my case. I mean, I was approaching 40 20 years ago when I adopted Allison. I was a single, you know, successful radio person back then. Things have changed, and I'm a lot older now, but that was exactly my story. And actually, my heritage is Russian, and so I was originally going to go to Russia. Oh. Right when I started the process was right when Vladimir Putin was first elected, and one of the first things he did was close down international adoptions. And so, you know, the agency I was working with kept sending me things, and nothing was right. And then one day they said, there's this little girl in Kazakhstan that you need to take a look at. and they sent me her information and a video, and it was immediate. I just like, oh my God, that's her. So I knew. So your country has given me the greatest gift in my life. It's so nice to meet you, especially today.
And you're welcome to Kazakhstan one day. If you want to have a fellow sent to visit your country, I'll not see. Just let me know. Oh. You're much welcome.
Oh, thank you. And we may take you up on that one of these days when the virus clears and my finances are in better shape. But absolutely. Shulpan Primbatova, it's such a pleasure to meet you. You know, look, I'm not a fan of Facebook. It does a lot of bad stuff, but it opens the world to us, and that's how we connected in this room view from my window Facebook group. That's so incredible. It's such a pleasure to talk to you. I thank you so much, and I hope we can stay in touch. And one of these days, I'll connect you with Allison when she's awake, and you can meet her. I'm sure she would love to know somebody in her birth country. You know, she's got dual citizenship, so you never know. Have one last question for you. How are things over there politically? I mean, Kazakhstan, as I said, when I adopted her, there were people who would say, where's Kazakhstan? They had no idea. It is such a huge nation that obviously split off from Russia when the Soviet Union broke up. How are things politically? What's Kazakhstan's relationship with Russia like these days?
We are not only neighbors, but we are political siblings. Mm-hmm. So we are trying to be in between huge державs like Russia and China. So Russia is our north neighbor. China is our east neighbor. Yes. So we are trying to dance in between and to save our territory. Yes. So we are very... And we have our own like trade union where Kazakhstan and Russia are members. So we're actual friends, because in Kazakhstan we still like have a legacy of Soviet Union. We speak Russian. Mm-hmm. We have two languages, Russian and Kazakh.
Right.
So Kazakh is our mother tongue, and Russian is still language of communication. So if you travel to Kazakhstan, you can easily use Russian language.
Which I did. Спасибо. Большое спасибо. I remember a few things. До свидания.
Food is amazing, because we are a mix of Central Asian food. That you can have Kazakh, Kyrgyz, Uzbek food. It's like Silk Road legacy. A lot of Russian food. Mm-hmm. And because during the post-Soviet, post-war migration of Korean people, they have a lot of Korean people who are forced to leave Russian part of eastern part of Russia by Stalin, and he was forced to steps to Kazakhstan, and they have a lot of Korean food. So food is amazing. It's multi-ethnic country with about like 100 ethnicities who live here, different religions. So it's very easy to live, socialize, enjoy the nature. It's a beautiful country. You can go for hiking in winter. This winter, unfortunately, we almost missed with our skiing and snowboarding. It's just 40 minutes of drive, and you from Almaty, you will see beautiful skiing.
Oh, I think we visited it when during our waiting period. There was a 15-day waiting period after court till we could get her papers and leave. So we did a little bit of sightseeing. We did go to a beautiful ski resort, very, very steep mountains. And we were there in November and December, so it was pretty cold. And I live in Florida, where at the time I lived in California, so I'm used to the sunshine. But I would love to come back and visit one day. I'm so happy to connect with you, and I know Allison will be overjoyed. So I will share this with her and stay in touch. Shulpan Primbatova, am I saying Primbatova?
Yep.
Thank you. Thank you so much. What a pleasure this has been.
Thank you. Stay safe, Nicole.
Thank you.
Allison and guys, stay safe, and all the best to you. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. You too. And you too. Stay safe. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye.